Okay, I'm Rick Fleeter, and I'm going to talk first about microspace, basically what it is. So I'm going to wrap up with some examples of small missions just to prove that there really are small missions out there, not necessarily ones you've ever heard of. The first one is, let's assume there's Virgin Galactic, and you want to enhance the Virgin Galactic experience. You want to make that tourism experience even better. What's missing from Virgin Galactic? Two things we could think of right off the bat with my students in Rome. One is, there's no Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is everywhere. You're going to spend $250,000 to go on a vacation to a hotel that has no Wi-Fi. Okay, it's a hotel, you're only in for 20 minutes. But still, why would you want Wi-Fi on Spaceship 2, you know, Galactica? Because you want to take a picture with your smartphone in real time and send it to your family and say, here I am, guys, I'm in orbit, floating in the cabin in zero G. For $250,000, they ought to give you that, right? But it's a hard thing to do in a suborbital rocket. The other thing you'd like is a picture of yourself waving out the window. Here I am with space and the Earth behind me waving out the window. So you really need a companion satellite to leave Spaceship One and take and just do video, right? It's got an S-band link to the ground, it's streaming video, and it's also using that S-band link to bring the internet up, and then it provides a Wi-Fi environment that you can log into and take a picture with your smartphone and send it on WhatsApp or whatever. So what would it take to do that? And we did the design of that down in Rome a couple of years ago, and what it would take to do that is a little, in quotation marks, satellite about this big, right? Sort of your typical, what they call, at least in Canada, a hockey puck. And that little satellite separates itself from Spaceship 2 or whatever the version is when they finally get to fly it, and just slowly drifts away from it while it's in the zero gravity, zero drag part of its height, of its parabolic arc. And while it's drifting away, it's focusing back and taking that picture and providing that Wi-Fi environment. As soon as you reach the atmosphere, this thing has a ballistic coefficient much smaller than Spaceship 2. And so Spaceship 2 re-enters, but you re-enter much more slowly, and the two separate, and it's the end of the mission. So that's a small satellite, quote-unquote small satellite mission, that's never going to fly if we don't start thinking about where we want to go today, right? Some of my students in Rhode Island took an idea that was developed by a graduate student at MIT of fabricating solar panels with essentially a laser or dot matrix printer. So it's a dot matrix printer, but it's a little bit of a dot matrix printer on steroids, because it doesn't print on paper, it prints on aluminized mylar, and it doesn't print with ink, it prints with the etching chemicals that are used to make solar panels in a factory. But it's still a dot matrix printer, and you take a roll of mylar, which can be 10 meters long, 100 meters long, a kilometer long, and you just slowly deploy that roll of aluminized mylar, and as it's deploying, you print the solar panels onto it. So that allows you to build very large solar arrays in space so that they don't need to have any structure. They're stabilized basically by gravity gradient or by drag, or you figure it out. And the design that these students did, using the actual numbers from the MIT design that this woman wrote into her PhD thesis, were able to show that on a satellite, 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter, with 1 square meter of solar panels on the top to get things started, because you need some power before you start building the solar panels to turn the printer on and everything and heat it up, was at least capable of making 4 solar arrays, 1 meter wide by 20 meters long, which is about equal in power to the most powerful geosynchronous satellites currently out there, about 10 kilowatts. For nothing, on a satellite that would weigh 100 kilograms and fit in 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter. So that could change everything, right? All of a sudden, a small satellite could be a 10 kilowatt satellite, small satellite being a meter in characteristic dimension. So that's a use of small satellite. Go up and do that. Go up and deploy enormous solar panels in space. See if you can really make 10 or 20 kilowatts from a 1 meter cube. The next mission that I wanted to talk about was another one that has not yet happened, which is to put CubeSats in orbit around the moon. And in order to do that, we cheated a little bit because we built a third satellite called the Taxi satellite. And the Taxi satellite does the orbital transfer from geosynchronous transfer orbit to the lunar orbit, and supports the two CubeSats in orbit so that they don't have to communicate all the way to the ground. So you still have a microsatellite mission. You have 2 1-kilogram CubeSats and then a 25 to 50 kilogram Taxi satellite that does the communications and propulsion system support for those other two. So for a 100 kilogram mission, under 100 kilogram, well under 100 kilogram mission, maybe 52 kilogram mission, you have a lunar mission. And when people talk about small lunar satellites, till now they've been talking about 375, the Swedish mission, 375, 380 kilograms. By using the small satellite technology and using a little bit of infrastructure that you carry with you, you can have the first lunar mission, 52 kilograms, and then send more CubeSats to the moon, and those missions would have even a lower mass because the infrastructure is now already there. There are students in other universities building thrust modules for CubeSats to give them the ability to do that, staying in sun-synchronous low Earth orbit. And then I have a slide here. Actually, this slide was the precursor to a real mission that we're now doing at Brown, which is to fly a flash in space, not a flash bulb, but a beacon, something like a flashing beacon that runners carry or bicyclists have on them. Why would you do that? Why would you want to have a flashing beacon in space? Well, the reason for doing it on this mission is it's going to be a toy. And the toy is, you send a radio signal, it flashes back to you. So if you succeed in reaching the satellite with a little pulse, the satellite answers by saying, I heard you, and it flashes in a little pattern. You can tell it the pattern. You want dot, 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 it hears you, it sends back dot, dot, dot. Fantastic. It's like, why would you do that? Because it'd be a hell of a lot of fun. See the satellite going overhead, and you're like trying to get it to send the first letter of your first name in Morse code. So I want dot, dash, dot, you know, and I want that sent up to the, I want to see if the satellite will answer me. And it'd just be a game. Can you get it or somebody else gets it? It's a little bit, you know, but why else would you do that? Because sooner or later, people are going to do various kinds of illumination from space. One of those kinds of illumination will be to have signage in space, like a logo, like you're doing the Olympics opening committee and you want to have flags. Flags are basically logos of countries. Every country has its own logo. Long before there was the Nike swoosh, there was, well, the Italian flag is a particularly trivial logo because it's one stripe of green, one stripe of white, and one stripe of red. So that's pretty easy, right? So you get a few satellites that are red, a few satellites that are white, a few satellites that are green, and if you can keep them in that constellation, like a big dot matrix printer in a way, you can print in space the Italian flag. And then an instant later, you can switch it to the American flag, and then you can switch it to the French flag, which is nearly identical to the Italian flag, and so on and so on and so forth, so on, and flash all the flags of all the countries participating in the Olympics in space. That's not doable with current technology. It's not bright enough. We don't have enough satellites. We don't know how to control them. How do you get started on that? Fly a flasher in space. See if you can see it. Then do two flashers in space. See if you can coordinate between the two. Fly 1,000 of these guys in space all together in a disorganized constellation that kind of has a map within it through Bluetooth, through whatever, of where each one is, and turn on the ones in blue that are part of the blue part of the French flag, turn the ones on in white that are part of the white part of the French flag, etc. So maybe by having a swarm of tens of thousands of satellites that is in orbit, timed to pass over the Olympics at a particular time during the opening ceremony, for 10 minutes, you can flash all the flags of all the nations. And like, why is that worth doing? Because why is anything, why is the Olympics worth doing? We spend billions of dollars on it, apparently. Spend billions, millions of dollars just on the opening ceremony. If you can make this into that category, you suddenly have a whole new space application and people become aware of it. The other two pictures on this slide were one of an impactor that impacts the moon at very high velocity to do research on the lunar regolith, and another that is to provide a 10 centimeter objective optic astronomical telescope in space for students to use. Every university has a telescope on the roof, but telescopes on the roof are like from the 18th century, right? The way we do astronomy now, we do astronomy from space. And the way to do astronomy for everybody from space, we can't all have the Hubble Space Telescope. You fly a very simple satellite. One university is the node for that satellite. Other universities put in, I want to look at this for 10 seconds or 10 minutes on this night at this, or this day at this particular time. And everybody shares time on the satellite and gets space telescope. It's not that every university needs its own. We're not talking about 10,000 space telescopes. 1, 2, 10, 20 would be enough that every student in the world would have access to their own space telescope. So then there's the micro-robotics vehicles. We did a whole conference one year on micro-robotic vehicles. Is it really necessary to land 100 kilograms on the moon to do robots on the moon? No. It's sufficient to land 100 grams on the moon if you have the infrastructure. 10 grams is already a rover. There are rovers that weigh 10 grams. So if you have rovers that weigh 10 to 100 grams, That means a small satellite mission to the moon can put rovers on the moon. And rover is a rover, right? If you have enough of them, you can cover the whole moon. I mean, the moon's a big place. You're never going to cover it with one rover. I should live so long. You're going to need thousands of rovers. So if you need thousands of rovers, they have to weigh less than tens of kilograms each, or it's not practical. And this is the way to make it practical. So when you look at other things in the world, the criticism of small satellites is what? That they're toys. That they don't land on comets. That they don't put people on the surface of the moon. Right? But in the commercial world, there's something called disruption. And what's disruption? Disruption is, it's good enough. There's wonderful Nikon, Canon, single lens reflex cameras out there. They're fantastic cameras. They're so much better than the cameras in cell phones. But 99.9% of the photographs in the world are made with cell phones. Why is that? Because 99% of the people in the world, it's good enough. Why should I read that instruction manual? Why should I lug those 2 kilograms around? I don't need it. Right? It's good enough. And the same thing with audio. Everybody's got an MP3 player of some form. In fact, we seldom even bother to carry. It's just embedded inside of your smartphone. But there is a company called Macintosh. They sell high-end audio systems. They cost $50,000, $100,000. Okay, they're much more capable. The music is much more beautiful to hear, but nobody's using them. Right? And that's where space is going. We've become the Macintosh. In terms of Macintosh, not Macintosh Apple, Macintosh high-end tube amplifiers that make stunning audio. That's great for the few people who can afford them, but the law of disruption is the people for whom it's good enough are the people who make the market. Okay, that's a capitalistic argument. But which technology is changing how we live? Is the Canon single-lens reflex camera changing how we live? But is the camera in your iPhone changing how we live? It really is. Every time something happens in the world, terrible thing happens in an airplane, people are in the airplane taking movies of it with their iPhone. Everything that happens, it's changed the world. Every single thing that happens now is recorded on video, not because of 2 kilogram single lens reflex cameras, but because of smartphones, right? So which is pioneering the field? Which is spearheading new technologies? All the technology thrust is to make those smartphone cameras better, that they're focusing and they have these semi-elastic electrostatic lenses that do focusing, that they have zoom, that they do all these things with no moving parts. Which one touches more people, right? How many people's lives are touched by a single lens reflex big Nikon? Relatively few. How many people's lives are touched by the cameras and smartphones? Like everybody. Nobody goes through a day of their life without seeing at least one photo made by a smartphone. Right, of something that they care about, right? Which one is capturing the imagination of young people? It's, again, that technology that's in the hands of billions of people. And which is the one that's leading to more innovations? It's the disruptive one. It's the good enough one. It's the trashy one that's not really doing anything. So we run around in the space business saying, yes, but we're doing all these fantastic missions. And to me, it's like, that's exactly the wrong thing to be doing. You should be doing all these trivial missions and putting in the hands of a billion people like we did with the smartphone. And then seeing how many lives do you touch? How relevant is space to people? How many good ideas are now popping up to make that thing even better, right? And that's what changes the world. And if your real goal in space is to change the world, to make it better for people, then we're doing exactly the wrong thing to land on comets. As beautiful as that is, as beautiful as Apollo was, it's not as powerful as making every person capable of participating in the space enterprise. And that's what we're talking about. Simple missions, short lifetime, self-organized team of a few people that can be one person, self-documenting, right? No components list, no approved parts list, just do it kind of thing. And the ability to launch all those missions, right? And to quote Arthur Clarke, one of my favorite smart people, not in the world anymore, but certainly in the world, in the minds of a lot of us, how long will it take to change space so this disruptive thing happens and we stop pushing the idea that everybody should be an astronomer and start making space that people who are not astronomers are going to relate to? Arthur Clarke's response to that kind of question is 25 years after we stop laughing. We haven't even stopped laughing. At this point, we still think of small missions as basically toys for students to play with and big missions as real space. So we're still laughing about small satellites. I've been in small satellites for almost 30, 40 years now. And we're still laughing about them. We still don't get it that the smartphone camera is the camera that matters, and the fancy SLR camera is irrelevant to 99.9% of the people in the world, no matter how beautiful it is, as an item of technology, right? And that means killing the idea of a mission as what you go to space to do. I have a mission. I'm going to land on a moon of, you know, some planet and, you know, explore the surface or its lake or whatever that is, drill through the ice, all those kinds, those are fantastic missions. But just the very fact, to the average person on the street, who does those missions? Like, nobody I know. You know what I mean? These people have PhDs in astrophysics. That's like untouchable to most of the population. So that's really where I'm going. Ridding, putting myself out of business, that you shouldn't need smart people to build the satellites that other people want. They should really be building them themselves. Maybe they wouldn't really build them themselves. Maybe they would just buy this off-the-shelf thing the way they buy a cell phone, do whatever they want to do in space, whatever toy they want to run, whatever thing they want to do. I mean, I don't build my own cell phone, but I participate in that technology. So that, in a very long story, is, you know, what makes small satellites different than other satellites. To wrap it up, the main thing is the mission mindset. Where do you want to go today? That's what we have to change. What do we take seriously in space? Then the reliability question, the complexity question, the limiting the team size question, and then how do you launch it? And how the launch environment affects what we can do in space. And those are really the elements of what makes microspace, microspace.